So this is Palm Sunday. This is April the 9th, 2017. Our regular videographer is ill, so we're trying a different approach here today to see if we can still get onto to YouTube. I hope we can. I think we can. We'll try to do it. The one national event that I want to let you all know about, in the back of your flyers, you can watch this on our YouTube, just go to our, not YouTube, to our website, and you'll get all the information about whatever's coming up. I think this is going to be prove a really exciting weekend. It's in October 5th through the 8th in North Carolina. Donna Carey, who's my very, 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 very favorite singer, A Course in Miracles leader, and has been so since 1991 when we first met. There's just one other guy, John Mark Stroud, who's going to be there, and I'll be there, and then we have several other women leaders, including, for example, Jennifer Hadley, who was here at our last class that we had back in March. Okay. I'll think of others along the way. So, also with regard to our future, David Fishman's going to be with me in May, so we'll be sharing the back and forth kind of at that time. And then in June and July, and maybe I've always taken August off, but I looked at the calendar and realized I'm going to be here that day, so maybe we'll do August as well. Our vacation is not until the 2 weeks after that, so we will be in town. When I originally did the entire text of the course, I did the 50 Miracles Principles in one shot. And to do 50 Miracles Principles in one lecture was a bit much. So I think I'd like to go back and take at least two classes, maybe even three classes, to go through the 50 Miracles Principles. So in June and July, for sure, I'm going to do the 50 Miracles Principles, and perhaps in August as well. It'll take a while to get through it. Partly based on the new book, The Unintended, an annotated copy of the course, because it reveals a lot more about the 50 Miracles Principles than we've seen previously, right? That's that. So let's turn to our topic for today. This is a very, very, very important topic. It's also a difficult topic. The reason why it's a difficult topic is I don't think a lot of people believe it. Now, what I mean by that, our topic is perfect happiness. So I've written three books in the last 6 years on the course. As you know, one, Living A Course in Miracles, which did very well. And the most recent book, Eternal Life in A Course in Miracles, which has done very well. And in between, the book on perfect happiness, which has not done as well. And I think it's in part because nobody buys it. That you can interpret by in more than one way. By, I mean by the idea that there is such a thing as perfection, and that it's possible for us to know a perfected state, right? And it's true that this world is not a perfect world. And indeed, it's true that the ego games are part of the imperfection of this world. But if God is perfect, if heaven is perfect, and if heaven is our goal, and God is our goal, then the only way that you ever get to really know that is by recognizing your own perfection. So who's Jesus? Jesus is really someone who recognizes his own perfection. I think this really happens at the point of his wandering in the 40 days and the 40 nights in the wilderness. There's not a word of ministry until after that event occurs. So there's this kind of really deep soul-searching thing that goes on, which can either drive you crazy or it could get you enlightened, one of the two. And in his case, it brought him to enlightenment, to the realization of the truth of who he was, who you are, who we are, who everyone is. You are a perfect child of God. The Course talks about it being the son of God. Don't get upset if it uses the word son and you're a lady or a woman. We're not talking about sex, right? It has nothing to do with that kind of a division. So I want to tell you a little parable to start with. And the parable is the story of the king's son. So once upon a time, in an ancient kingdom, there lived a king and a queen, and they had a beautiful 4-year-old son who had a distinctive mark, a birthmark on his shoulder that looked very much like a heart. One night, thieves broke into the castle. They killed the king and they killed the queen and they abducted the young prince. And they stole whatever else they could get their hands on. And they traveled very rapidly, very far away. The next morning, the minister found the bodies of the king and the queen and concluded correctly that the boy had been abducted. So immediately, soldiers were sent out throughout the kingdom to try to find the prince. But they never found him. Years and years and years went by. 15 years went by, and they never found the boy. And then word came that actually he had been found in a very, very remote village. Now, the soldiers were told that if they found him, they were not to tell the boy about who he was, nor anybody else around the boy. The minister wanted to come and interview the boy first and see if he had any memory of this particular event. The minister comes, sees the boy, sees the birthmark, and he tells him the story about once upon a time there was a king and a queen who were murdered and their son was abducted. And the legend had it that someday this boy would return. He's the rightful heir, he's the king, and he would restore his country to its former prosperity and well-being that it had experienced once upon a time. And the boy got very excited. He says, this is wonderful news to think that there is such a king, and when he's found, he will bring prosperity back to our village and to the kingdom. And then the minister says, well, I have to tell you that I know that you are that boy. And he kind of looks around to the left and the right. He kind of goes, well, what's he talking about? Because I'm no king. I'm a peasant. I'm a farmer's boy. And then the minister says, well, I have unrefutable proof that you are indeed the son, the rightful heir. And he tells him about the birthmark of that looks like a heart that's on his shoulder. And sure enough, it's there. And as further proof, he turns to the couple and he says to them, did you give birth to this boy? And they said, no, we have been childrenless, but many years ago, some strangers came through and they sold us the boy because we wanted to have a son and we were never able to do so. So we have been the ones who raised him. So the next day, the boy wakes up, but he still can't get it into his, he's a peasant, he's a farmer, he's not a king. This doesn't make any sense. It doesn't fit into his framework, and it takes a very, very long time for him to begin to awaken to the realization that he is who the minister says he is. So what's fun about that story is that that's really your story and my story and everyone's story. The story is that you're a perfect child of God. and that you always have been, and you have your natural inheritance is the kingdom of heaven. It's guaranteed. This is your natural inheritance is the kingdom of heaven. And just like Jesus, at some point you will remember that this is your home. When Jesus is standing in front of Pontius Pilate, Pontius Pilate says to him, now keep in mind, Jesus would have been accused of heresy, of claiming that he was the Son of God, right? That's why he's brought up on trial. When Herod says to, when Pontius Pilate says to Jesus, are you a king? His response is, yes, but my kingdom is not of this world. Yes, but it's not here, but it's not in this world. So this is what the Course is trying to remind us of, that you are actually a perfect child of God, but you're dreaming, you're sleeping. You have this false idea in your mind that you're somebody else and that you're living out a dream that you're, and that you think the dream is real. Okay, now let's go on. So, this is from Jonathan. I have a lot of Jonathan Livingston Seagull quotes today. We have Course, Jonathan Livingston Seagull, Course, Jonathan Livingston Seagull. What's really interesting about Jonathan Livingston Seagull is that, first of all, it was written in, how many of you read Jonathan Livingston Seagull? Yeah, of course. And you're like, you know, 3/4 of the room at least, raise your hand. It came out in 1972, and it stayed on the New York Times bestseller list for 2 years, throughout 1972 and it sold 44 million copies. 44 million is a tremendous number of copies. Anything that sells 10 million would be a phenomenal thing, but to sell 44 million. And it's because it rang true for so many people. You can pass through back. So this is a quote from Jonathan Livingston Seagull. Do you have any idea how many lives we must have gone through before we ever got the first idea that there's more to life than eating or fighting or power in the flock? All right? This is Jonathan Livingston Seagull's teacher, Chang, I think his name was, who's talking. And then another 100 lives until we began to learn that there is such a thing as perfection. And another 100 again to get the idea that our purpose for living is to find that perfection and show it forth. This is what the Course in Miracles is also saying. Now, one of the things that's interesting about the Jonathan Livingston Seagull is like the Course in Miracles in miniature, right? And I think it's interesting that it came out about the same time as the Course. The Course wasn't published until June 22nd. 1976. So this is a little prior to the Course, right? But Richard Bach, who wrote Jonathan Livingston Seagull, said that he did not write it. That just as Helen Schuckman scribed the Course in Miracles, Richard Bach scribed Jonathan Livingston Seagull. It was given to him as a gift. And we've talked about in the past how very often that'll be the case, that it comes as a gift, whether that was Hildegard of Bingen, St. Teresa of Avila, Bridget of Sweden, all said that they were given their books, and that it came to them often in a flash. It was just Mozart said he didn't write his sonatas. You can keep Ramanujan said he didn't come up with his theorems that he discovered, if you've seen his movie, The Man Who Knew Infinity. It was given to him. And I just got through listening to a book called Reality Isn't What You Think by an Italian physicist who said, and I think it was Fermi, who said he understood electromagnetic energies, but he was not a mathematician, so he couldn't put it down. He had to get another friend, Maxwell, who was a mathematician, to actually write it, but he explained it. So we were talking in our all-faith seminary class yesterday about, this is what the transcendentalists are talking about. What I'm talking about is that there's another kind of knowledge, which is not bookish knowledge, but it's a kind of knowledge that is given to you. But you have to be able to open your mind to be able to receive it. This is very common for the mystics. You know, they get this awareness or this knowledge. It's like when you have a death experience, right? You get a new knowledge. You see something. I'm looking at Cora here, who had a near-death experience. And you see something there that's very hard. You know it's real. There's no doubt about it, right? It's very difficult to try to explain to somebody else, though, because it's an experience. And because it's an experience, even if you put it into words, it's still difficult for somebody else to begin to grasp it. He's very clever in Jonathan Livingston Seagull and using the methodology that he does, because it puts it in a kind of a graphic way. The course is not graphic. It doesn't have very many illustrations at all in the whole course. And my good friend Ken Wapnick very rarely used illustrations, I noticed, and when he would talk about the course. Now, we're going to try three. All right?
Try it.
That's not three. Oh, well, maybe that's... It's not there. What the heck? It's the one with the checks. There's it. Can you click on the checks? Okay, you got it. So, can we shut that? You're getting it? It's okay. The rest of you take warning there, hon. So, I was ordained a Methodist minister in 1970, and I just thought I'd share this with you because it has to do with what we were talking about today. When you're ordained a Methodist minister, there are certain things you have to promise. Now, promises are always a little difficult because it kind of puts you into a box. Because once you promise it, if you break the promise, right, if you step outside of the box, now you're in trouble, right? So, these are the things we had to promise. Number one, we had to say that we affirmed that we were called into ministry. I had no doubt about that, absolutely. It was in my DNA from as early as I can remember. I told my folks when I was 9 years old that I was going to be a minister, right? So, they said, fine, but why? And I said, because I'd rather be the one that's up there yelling rather than the one that's sitting and listen to it. That's partly true. Partly not true. I said, too religious not to go to church. But as long as I was going to go, I wanted to be involved, right? Okay. So, two, we had to say that we accepted Jesus as our personal Savior. Check. That wasn't a problem as I understood it at the time. Yes, that was fine. No problem. Three, we had to say that we believed in a triune God rather than a Unitarian God. Okay, well, check again, slight but. I mean, the Course talks about the Holy Spirit and Jesus, and so we do have this sort of three things, but there's really just one. There's just one mind, actually. These are just different ways of talking about the one mind. Okay, so that's not a real problem. Four, we had to say that we believed that the Bible was the authoritative standard of life. Now, at this point, we had all graduated from 3 years of intensive study in the ministry, and we'd taken classes in biblical criticism, and we all knew that the Bible was really pretty much a mixed bag, and although no doubt it contains the truth, especially in something like Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, it's just... It's so beautiful that you know it's true, but there are other times we know that this an eye and a tooth for a tooth kind of stuff doesn't work. So there was one young man in particular who was very upset about this particular one because he just thought the Bible was really a mixed bag. But okay, and then now we get to five and six. Five, we had to say that we would abstain from the use of alcohol. I don't know whether you know it or not, but the Methodists were really behind the prohibition in the 1920s, big time here. And so, well, I was happy not to abuse alcohol. Yeah, I would agree not to abuse alcohol, but to abstain a glass of wine at dinner is kind of nice. Number six, this was really the big one. Ministers had to vow of single ministers. Had to take a vow of celibacy. Okay, so I'm 27, 28 years old at this point, living in Greenwich Village, doing doctoral studies at the New School University, had not yet met my wife. I was looking for her. And 1969 is when the pill came out, and Hair opened on Broadway, and we were beginning to experience something called the sexual revolution. So this was really, oh my God. No. All right. Seven, we had to say that we were headed toward perfection. Now, that was good. Number seven was I had total agreement with number seven. So there was a retreat before the ordination. So there was a group of us that approached our teachers and administrators and talked about this, because we said, look, we don't have to do five and six, okay? And the rest of them are okay, but five and six are really problematic. And so what they said was, well, look, it's really only the more conservative older members who really are in agreement with this, and we realize that this is a little problem, but what we'd like for you to do is just say yes, okay? So, actually, there was one young woman there who I was very, very proud of. She did refuse to perjure herself. And so she turned down the ordination. And she later became a very respected college professor, but she wouldn't agree to it, right? The rest of us lied. Okay, so now here's the catch-22 is we're headed toward perfection. And we're being asked to lie. I'll say no more about that at the point. Okay, let's go on. Oops, I skipped one. Oops, I skipped two. What happened? Can we get back to... Okay, here we are. Thanks, Paul. Huh? Are we going to be okay there? Okay, good. Thanks. We had to get off the screen on the side. I understand. So let's begin with a few basic premises. Number one, there is no perfection in this world. This is not, everything about this world says it's not a perfect world. And you can look at that in many, 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 many different dimensions. It's all true. It's a world where, well, to live, a lot of things got to eat something else. They got to kill something else in order to live, right? So, two, if you have a body, you have an ego, which is imperfect, right? Three, if you have a mind, you have a spirit, which is perfect. So it's really the spirit that matters. Four, heaven is a state of perfection. We never left. So this is why it's a memory. That's why it's bringing it back into the mind. Five, the kingdom of heaven is in you. We said that a moment ago. It's not in your body, because the body is ephemeral. All bodies die. There are religions, Mormons are one of them, in which they think you're going to have a body when you go to heaven. Pretty much like the body you got now, a perfect body, right? But the Course says you're not even for a single instant are you a body. They're totally ephemeral. They don't, in case you haven't noticed, they don't last very long. Even 80 years or 90 years doesn't add up to very much, and it's out of here, right? Because it's something that's material. There's nothing which rusts, rots, decays, that's capable of turning from one form into another form that has any eternity in it at all. The mind, however, is something which cannot die, because it is eternal. It's always been there. That's why we have the book called Eternal Life. So the mind is formless and eternal. It cannot die. God's function is ours, and happiness cannot be found apart from our joint will. So we're going to spend some time now talking about what it means to have a joint will with God. So The world has not yet experienced any comprehensive reawakening or rebirth. Such a rebirth is impossible as long as you continue to project or miscreate. And we're talking about the world as a whole, but we're talking about our individual minds. As long as one of the ways you can tell you're not enlightened, there's lots of ways. But one is to see if you ever get angry, right? If there's still anger in you at any level, if you can still get angry, you can be 100% sure that's ego that's grabbed you. It's got a hold of you. And what you really want to do if that happens is really stop and look very, very carefully and see why is that going on in your mind? Why are you thinking that way? And you may feel total justification. And all the more reason to look. You know, righteous indignation is really the worst form of indignation. When you're right. When you're right, you can be sure you're wrong. Okay? You may be right about what you're right about, but you're still wrong. You're wrong because you allowed yourself to go crazy. You've slipped off into insanity. Right? It still remains within you, however, to extend as God extended his spirit to you. So when it says it still remains within you, when he says extend, we substitute the word love. Okay? So it's still possible to love as God loves. As God loves his spirit. I mean, as he extends his spirit to you. In reality, this is your only choice because your free will was given to you for your joy in creating the perfect. So here's the big, big, big problem that we'll talk about in some more detail. It's called free will. You have free will, which is essentially how we got into this mess in the first place. What we did was we said to God, thank you very much, God, I'd rather do it myself. Having free will, you have every right to do that, and God cannot stop you, right? As in the story of the prodigal son, you're given your inheritance, you go off, you do what you want to do. It has to be that way because you have got to make the choice, just like Jesus made the choice to remember who he was. We all have to make this choice. It can't be forced on you. Let's go on. So, time is a trick. A sleight of hand, the vast illusion which figures come and go, yet there's a plan behind appearances that does not change. The script is written. So what happens if God sees that we are his children and we are sleeping? So he set up a plan by which we might awaken. It's up to us to follow the plan. And the Course is very, very clear that there are two voices which speak to us all the time. Those two voices are the voice of the Holy Spirit, always there, 24/7, never not there, even within the Courses, even in while you're sleeping. It's still communicating with you. All the time. There's never a time the Holy Spirit's not communicating with you. At the same time, we've got this thing called the ego, which is wanting to do it the way it wants to do it, which is, again, the thing that's the trouble. So the script is written. Let me try to explain this a little bit. I wish I had a graph. I would graph this out. Let's draw a dot up here, and let's put the dot, and we'll say that this is God, and this is perfect. This is heaven. This is reality, this is truth, this is what's real, right here, and this one kind of dot. And I'm going to kind of draw a couple lines going down from this. I remind you, I think later we'll have this quote in here. Broad is the way, wide is the path, it's directly from the Bible now, Matthew 7, which leads to destruction. Many there are that go therein. Narrow is the gate, that leads into life. Narrow is the way that leads into the gate, that that leads into life, and few there are that go therein, right? So it takes a lot to really get this right, to hone this down to the point where we're really, really, really just following only one voice. But it's possible to follow only that one. And as you know, as I've said in the past, I'm personally convinced that Dr. Ken Wapnick had completed the atonement before he passed, and that Dr. Bill Fedthard had completed the atonement before he, but they got it. Took a lot of work. If you asked Bill during the last years of his life what he was doing, he would say practicing forgiveness. Until the day came, which you've heard me talk about before, the day before he died, he said, "I'm done. I'm finished. I'm through." You know, that he'd completed it. He completed the whole thing, right? He was very, very happy. And he left the next day. He didn't know he was going to be leaving, right? When the spirits will come to end, your doubting has been set. So everybody's going to wake up. This is good news, right? Everyone will remember. And we'd like to say, well, the sooner the better, right? But we see the journey from the point at which it ended. Looking back on it, imagine we make it once again, reviewing mentally what has gone by. Now, part of what that's all about is our tendency, for example, to live in the past. And we spend a great deal of time living in the past because the past is your story. So who would you be without your story? And yet the truth of the matter is that to really awaken, the story is the dream. So you got to awaken from the story in order to remember, and you got to actually get back to the May-June issue of Miracles magazine. My article is titled Stopping the Mind. It's really getting back to stopping the mind, which is also a basic principle in Zen Buddhism, right? In order to be able to see, you've got to stop the mind. You've got to stop the projection in order to really be able to see. You cannot be projective and receptive at the same time. So you can't be broadcasting your own story and also listening to the truth. One of the two. Okay, let's go on. Truth lies only in the present, and you will find it if you seek it there. You have looked for it where it's not. We look for it in the world. We think it's in the world. It's never in the world. That's one of the things that Mark Twain realized, that it wasn't out there. There was, the Gilded Age was the worst example of it as far as he was concerned, right? Learn then to seek it where it is, and it will dawn on eyes that see. So obviously it's inside you. Right, the kingdom of heaven is inside you. That's where you're going to find it. You're not going to find it outside. So we've heard me talk in the past about GPS, God's plan for salvation. And this is God's plan. This is the message that gets you home. So you add an element into the script you write. Think about this. This is an incredible piece of information here. You add an element into the script you write. So there's two scripts. Okay, so the script is, A, there's God's script. And God's script is a perfect script. That you would just follow this, just follow these directions. Just do what I ask you to do, and everything will work out perfect for you. You know, life will be smooth, it'll be easy, you'll realize, you'll remember the truth of who you are, and bang, you'll just get right back home again, right? But you add an element to the script you write for every minute in the day. So the script is something that says, it's also, there's a perfect script if we followed that script, if we followed God's script. At the same time, that's true, we're writing our own script along the side, which means that we're wandering back and forth. Broad is the way and wide is the path. So every once in a while you'll get into the center and everything, you'll be loving and receptive and giving, and everything is just like kind of like working out perfectly because you let your mind be in the right place for a while, but then something distracts you and you're off on the side somewhere thinking that there's some reality in oh, somebody's being angry with you, so you have a right to be angry with them, whatever. And all that happens now means something else. You take another element, and every meaning shifts accordingly. So we're constantly in this process. And so what the Course is trying to do is trying to get us down to just into the centered state of awareness, where the main process in the Course is the atonement. That is the path. But what the atonement is, you could talk about, when I say Bill completed the atonement, when I say Ken completed the atonement, it's like saying they got enlightened, right? And to use other kinds of language. What the atonement is in the Course, it's removing all the stuff that's not you. It's really a pathway of cleansing. It's really a process of purification. It's really a matter of getting rid of everything which is false. The Course is not about gaining anything or getting anything. It's really about removing, purging, getting down to where there's nothing left except for what is true. I think people go through this in hospice programs as well. If you're you get to that point where what's happening is you're beginning to let go of everything. Everything. You're letting go of the world. You're letting go of physical things, a house, place that you live. You're letting go of the idea of you as a doctor or a career or everything disappears. Everything goes. And then if you get down to this really peaceful place is when there's nothing left except the spirit, the truth of who you are, then you're home. Free, so to speak, right? Okay, so heaven, God, truth, eternity, love, home, self is our only eternal reality. Everything else is a dream, an illusion, a passing fantasy, sometimes a nightmare. So the dream is played out every night on television, on the news, okay? So that's the dreaming of the world, and we want to find out what's going on in the dream, in the bigger dream, the world's dream. So, and every piece of the world is getting a different interpretation of what the world's dream is, depending on where you're standing, right? So I like Alice in Wonderland saying, sometimes we forget this is all a dream. Yeah, that's very helpful. When people back in October, November, et cetera, last year were going crazy about the politics and the election, the main advice that I kept giving people was, don't let anything take the peace of God away from you. Just don't let some element within the context of the dream, don't make it so real that it can take the peace of God away from you. Nothing should be able to take the peace of God away. This is a passing thing. This is something that's happening in time. And seeing how that's true, it will, just like every element within it, it'll morph into something else. All right, go on. So, this is Jonathan Livingston Seagull. Now, isn't this interesting? Look at the first five words. Heaven is not a place, and it's not a time. Heaven is being perfect. Richard Bach, Jonathan Livingston Seagull. Course in Miracles, heaven is not a place. Same word. I love it when you find the same words, you know. And anybody ever read The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Universe by Douglas, I think, along 1979, I think it was, right? Which is because there's a line in there where the captain of the spaceship yells out, I would rather be right than happy! Which is exactly the line from A Course in Miracles, right? And there it is. I don't know whether, see, that was 79, and the Course came out in 76, and who's to say whether he knew about that or not? No way to know. So heaven is not a place nor a condition. It's merely an awareness of perfect oneness. So hopefully you've heard me say in the past that what we're doing here is increasing awareness. So that as you do the course, you should find that you are simply becoming more and more and more aware. And more and more and more aware. And you're becoming so much more aware that a lot of the ego game stuff, it's not even going to come up. I mean, you'll see it. You'll see it in other people. You'll see it in yourself. But you'll realize it's a game. And you'll make a very simple decision, which is, I'm not playing this game. You know, this is an insane game. This is a part of a dream. And I have no interest in running off and getting angry at you because of something that you did, or vice versa, right? Heaven's not a place nor a condition. It's awareness of perfect oneness and the knowledge that there's nothing else. Nothing outside this oneness and nothing else within. So this is the state. It's hard. I think it's difficult for us to try to imagine what oneness is without seeing pieces to it, right? But just let's accept this as being true. Yeah, you got a mic?
Yeah, I do. I'm reading this unabridged version of the Course in Miracles. It's quite beautiful. It's a lot of thorough extra reading. And it goes further. I just read this a couple days ago, so it's fresh in my mind, about in this unabridged version, it stops at, it is merely an awareness of perfect oneness, and then parentheses, it says, yet oneness is not what you think. Oneness is every part of being of the one mind in God. So all parts, the whole is greater than the parts, which is God. But we're the parts of God. So oneness is when every mind of the mind of God returns to that one mind is oneness.
Right.
So it's not referring to a singular. It's referring to all parts being of that one mind of God.
So it would be like a hologram.
Yeah, exactly.
Or DNA.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
But every
that helps me.
I think that's helpful
me.
For all of us.
Yeah.
Right. To think of it as holographic or like a DNA. Everything is contained in the one, in this tiniest little part, right? And that's a part of you.
Oh, that's okay.
So, back to Jonathan Livingston Seagull. But overcome space, and all we have is here. And all we have left, overcome time, and all we have is now. And in the middle of here and now, don't you think we might see each other once or twice? And I kind of like putting down on the far side of here, mystics enjoy meeting one another. Mystics enjoy meeting other mystics. Because when you do, you recognize that this is a brother or sister who is unencumbered with a lot of junk about the world. Right? I mean, that they're not trapped in projection and in analysis and interpretation, and they're just hanging out being, just being. There's a definition on page 70 called being is a state in which the mind is in perfect communication with all that there is. That's an interesting one. Being is a state in which the mind is in perfect communication with all this, so that there's this awareness. This is a mystical state. This is awareness of a connectivity. And when you have this awareness that you don't have loneliness and you can't have separation, even if you're alone, you know, or you're sitting under a tree somewhere, but you're really aware of all life that may be that's surrounding you at that point. And you're part of that life. The dog barking in the distance, you know, is a part of what you are, right? Regardless of what's going on. So, you cannot be happy unless you do what you, you will truly, and you cannot change this because it is immutable. It is immutable by God's will and yours, or otherwise his will would not be extended. You are afraid to know God's will. Why are we afraid to know God's will? Because you're afraid to know God's will because it looks like if God wins, you lose, which is true. The ego is a goner at that point. The ego loses out completely. But then let's keep in mind that that's a dream, which never had any reality in the first place. So nothing is really lost. Because you believe, I've added the word think, it is yours. This belief is your whole sickness and your whole fear. Watch out for beliefs. We can believe all kinds of insane things. And the harder you hold on to it, this is one of the reasons that traditional Christianity is dying. Because traditional Christianity is filled with belief systems. Right? You got to believe this. We were talking in class yesterday, say the Nicene Creed. If you ever know what the Nicene Creed is, some of you, I'm sure, do. Jesus descended into hell instead of the. It's pretty crazy to have to say that Sunday after Sunday, as you do in some of the churches. That's like promising that you'll be celibate, knowing it's a lie. Right? You want to lie? We're trying to get to the truth here. Right? So let's go. So here's a friend of mine. Our deepest fear is not, you probably know, this is one of her best-known quotes, right? Our deepest fear is not that we're inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we're powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that frightens us most. And it's interesting. There's a strange thing with Marianne. Marianne and I shared a brownstone. We lived in the same brownstone, the Upper West Side, in 1973. She was my girlfriend's roommate, right? The course wasn't published till 76, right? I was 30, she was 21 at the time. And she was trying to make it as a nightclub singer here in New York City. And we would go and sit and clap extra loud for this. And then I was teaching at the New School down the street here. Courses on esoteric and mystical, and she'd sit and we'd have coffee together, and she'd ask me all these questions about all these classes I was teaching and stuff. Remarkable. Why these overlaps? It's interesting. Okay, back to Jonathan Livingston. You must begin to know that you have already arrived, and your true nature lives as perfect as an unwritten number, everywhere at once across space and time. You must know that this whole thing is done. It's over. It's finished. You are home. You're in heaven. But you're having this dream that you're sitting here in this body, in this class, trying to remember what reality is, right? So this course has explicitly stated that its goal for you is happiness and peace. Happiness is a state of mind, and perfect happiness is perfectly possible because it already is. Right? That's the same thing that Jonathan Livingston Seagull quote. You've already arrived. It's done. And the reason it's done because it has nothing to do with time. Time is a trap. We saw that before. The body's a trap, and time is a trap. Because both time and the body are limitations. This is obviously a limitation. And I know you'd like to get beyond this sometimes, right? It'd be really fun not to have to deal with all of its pains and its aches and its appetites and its desires and all of that stuff. At the same time, time is also a trap because we feel like we're caught in the diurnal process of going day after day after day after day. I'm sure that some days come and you don't want to get up and go do the process. You know, but But you got to go through it, right? Until it ends. Right? So we want heaven. We can have it. Heaven is awareness of perfect oneness. Perfect oneness equals perfect happiness. So this is Ramana Maharshi. Says, happiness is your nature. It's not wrong to desire it. What's wrong is seeking it outside when it's inside. There's an interesting story about this particular picture. When the photographer who took this particular, this is one of the better pictures of Ramana Maharshi, maybe not coming out so good on it, but if you were to see it in raw nature, you'd see it was good. And Ramana Maharshi said to the photographer, do you have enough light? And Ramana and the photographer said, Swami, you are the light. And the way it is, I mean, it's when you see a better picture of this than this, it's like it's shining. It's like he's giving off the light, right? And that's what the Course in Miracles says too, is that the light is in you. It's not that your eyes see the light. The light is actually in you. That's why if you want to see, close your eyes. Ultimately, now our things are coming out a little different here, Paul. Doesn't matter. We'll work with it. Ultimately, only spirit mind exists. Nothing exists outside the mind. Mind is eternal, invisible, and formless. And yet, does anyone doubt that there is a mind? The fear is that when the body dies, the mind's going to go. Let's be really clear. The Course in Miracles is that the mind has nothing to do. This is very important. It has nothing to do with space-time. Okay? It's non-local. It's not in space and time. It completely transcends space and time. So we're trapped in bodies in space and in time. But the experience of the mind has no such limitation. And so that's what we're trying to get back to, is this memory. It's of this mind. Mind is everywhere, encapsulating everything. Mind cannot be dissected or broken into parts. These are all, what I did here is, these are just, I just took quotes from the Course without, that's like A line. So this is all from the Course. I'm not making this up. It's on my own. The mind is non-local. It's not bound by space-time. Space and time are beliefs. And belief is an ego function. So we're talking about a kind of function which is not, has nothing to do with the ego. And belief is an opinion. It's a point of view. So if I have a point of view or I have a belief, you know, there are no Republicans in heaven. Well, let me finish the sentence. There are no Democrats in heaven. There are no Christians in heaven. There are no Muslims in heaven. There are no Buddhists in heaven. Those are all belief systems. They're all concepts. They're all constructs. You know, what we have is a pure state of mind is not contaminated with that kind of stuff, which the world grabs onto and makes real and says there is such a thing. Well, there is no such thing. Right? So free will does not mean that you can establish the curriculum. It means only you can elect what you want to take at a given time. So we've got the straight way and the narrow gate. We've got all these things that we can believe on either side of the straight way and the narrow gate. But it's up to us to decide to follow the straight way that leads to the narrow gate, which leads into it. So we're wandering around as lost souls, and sometimes very, very lost. What the Course is, again, as you do the Course, you should simply become aware of the fact that a lot of the junk that you believed in the past, you're now free of. Okay, that's gone. you don't need that anymore, because that was just some sort of something you were grasping for straws. Remember I told you a couple of sessions back that St. Thomas Aquinas, after he wrote the Summa Theologica, which is 8 volumes, it's like that on a bookshelf, said it was so much straw. After he had his mystical experience, he said, that's all straw. Catholic Church is based on that straw. Okay. Ultimately, space is as meaningless as time, because the mind is atemporal. Atemporal is standing outside of time. The world we see is an outward picture of an inner condition. It's always an outward picture of an inner condition. And so I created this little thing over here on the side. Who is the I? You can do it a couple of different ways. The I that looks out upon the world. That's a really, it's an important question. And what's really helpful is getting down to the point where there isn't an I. Right? If there's no I, then you can see. If you see what I mean. One of my favorite quotes, I've shared this with you before, but let me do it again, because this is Emerson's mystical experience. Standing on the bare ground, my head bathed in the blithe air and uplifted into infinite space, all mean egotism vanishes. I become a transparent eyeball. I am nothing. I see all. The currents of universal being circulate through me. I am part and parcel of God. How does he get to be part and parcel of God? How does he see all? The sentences that come before that, I am nothing. See, that's what we have to get to. We have to get to I am nothing. That's stopping the mind, completely stopping it. I see all, but I see all only because I stop the mind. Otherwise, I'm evaluating the world, which includes gooding and prettying. It's a nice day out, right? I mean, it includes all of it. It includes all the interpretation. And there is a nice day out, but you know, it is also what it is. It could be raining. So we'll just do one or two more slides and we'll take our break. You must have noticed that an outstanding characteristic of every end that the ego has accepted on its own, when you achieve it, it has not satisfied you. So even if you get it, I told the story once before in class about a guy who came to see me once after taking a class on mysticism at the Open Center. And he sat down and he just said, he took me out to lunch and he says, you know, I got it all. I make a lot of money. I'm married to a woman that I'm in love with, great kids, nice home, love my work. Something's missing. Something's wrong. And what was missing was the spiritual dimension, right? The spiritual was the mind that was reaching that. So all the external stuff was there, and nothing was missing in that sense, but something was missing. So the ego shifts ceaselessly in the hopes of finding something. Anything in the world of time that will truly satisfy. And of course it does. I'll do one more, maybe two. You cannot be happy unless you do what you truly will, and you cannot change this because it is immutable. It is immutable by God's will and yours, for otherwise his will would not be extended. Did we have this before? You're afraid to know God's will because you believe it's yours. Okay. And let's stop at this. Let's take a break at this point, shall we?